Bianca Strauss.
And I am WWE Superstar and SmackDown Women's Champion Becky Lynch.
I can never get enough of you saying that, by the way.
Me neither.
Say it 100 times.
I'm SmackDown Women's Champion. I'm SmackDown Women's Champion. Woo! I'm SmackDown Women's Champion. I'm SmackDown Women's Champion.
And here we are. We're going to tell you guys and tell each other a little bit about our lives.
Yeah, a little bit of chit-chat. And how did you start? You started because you saw Steve Vai.
Okay. I saw a movie called Crossroads. And in this movie, this guitar player plays the devil's guitar player, and they do a duel in the movie. Like, the hero of the movie duels the devil's guitar player. And he's just evil, and he's cocky, and he gets in his face. He's playing the guitar upside down, and just, like, and I was like, bingo, that's me.
That's what you want to do. And you were 14?
13.
13?
13
when
old,
you started.
When I started. Okay. And then I just hit the ground running full speed and never did anything else. I don't do anything else except play guitar. You know, people say, what are your hobbies? And I go, I don't know. I work out. I didn't go to college. You know, I didn't get any other training. I didn't do anything else. I just said, this is what I want to do, and I'm going to do it.
I think it worked that well for you.
Yeah. You did the same, right, at 15?
Yeah, but I'm so curious as to, so then did you just throw out the athletics and stuff like that?
Completely. I was doing rhythmic gymnastics, and I was like all the way up to, I think it was number 11 in the top 10 in the country or on the junior Olympic team, and I think I was number 11 at that time. And I saw this movie, and literally the next day I went into the gym where I had been going all my life, and let's say my practice started at 5 p.m. I walked in at 5:15, and my coach, this really strict Ukrainian coach, she said, you're late. I was like, I know. Got my stuff out of my locker, and I left. And I never went back. And now that I think back on it, I'm appalled that I did that, because I didn't even say thank you to the coach that had seen me through the last formative years of my life, through my parents' divorce, through everything, you know, that I had gone through from age probably 5 until 13. Like, I didn't even say, hey, this is my decision. I'm going to go do this. Thank you. I was just like, I'm out. I'm done. I washed my hands of the whole, and I wish that I'd like to get in touch with her now and say, by the way, you were an amazing part of my life, and thank
That's
you.
Incredible.
Teaching me discipline and teaching me, you know, like, when you do a sport as a kid, it teaches you a lot of discipline. It teaches you that no one can practice for you, that no one can do your push-up for you, that, you know, that improving in your life is up to you and you alone.
Do you think that's what gave you the discipline to become as amazing at guitar as you are?
That's what gave me all the discipline I've ever had, I think. Because,
okay,
you know, it's doing a sport will do that to you.
Yeah.
You know, you learn at whatever age that getting, improving at something isn't something you can buy. And
yeah,
that's what I love. You know, my mom is a teacher, and she teaches at a really affluent private school. And the kids that I went to school with were like the Van Halen kids and the, you know, the Harrison Ford's kids, like these, you know, these actors and musicians and CEOs' kids. And, you know, my sister and I were just the kids of the teacher. You
yeah
know, we didn't have a fancy car for our birthday. You know, we didn't have all this stuff. And I loved doing these disciplines because it was something that no one could buy and something that no one could take away. You know, these kids may have a car, or they may have, you know, fancy shoes, or, you know, whatever else it is. But I have something that I worked for and that I earned, and that's always meant the world to me.
And how often would you have practiced? How did you learn? Where did you take your first class?
I'm totally self-taught.
Totally self-taught.
My dad taught me my first few chords. My dad's a musician.
Okay.
He taught me my first little bit, and he'll be the first to tell you I got better than him in the month, because I just was absorbing the guitar. I was like, I couldn't take it out of my hands. You could not get the guitar away from me. I was practicing. I would get home from school. I would take the guitar to school. This is what a nerd I was in school. I would take the guitar to school, and I would sit on the bench by myself, and I would practice between classes, not even at lunch. But, you know, in the 10 minutes between class, I would take the guitar out and sit on the bench out in the field and practice. And, you know, I'd get home, I'd practice, and then my mom would turn out the lights, and I'd sit in the dark and practice in the bed. And, like, I was obsessed. Like Conor McGregor says, I'm not talented, I'm obsessed.
Yeah.
And, you know, what is this great quote of Conor's? There's no hard work. There's no talent, there's only hard work. Anybody can be anybody if you put in the time. I'm not talented, I'm obsessed. And that's exactly what it was. I wasn't any good. Were you good at wrestling when you first started?
Awful.
Horrible.
Awful. I failed to pee. Because I thought I looked funny when I ran. Mm. So I would just refuse to run. So I'd stand there with my stick in my hand. My hockey stick. and just would refuse to run. I was not athletic whatsoever. I was
so you're not just a talented athlete that has this amazing opportunity that fell into your lap.
No, I probably, like, so Finn Balor trained me. His heart was probably broken because I was so bad. So bad, but I kept going in. I was like, I want to be as good as any of these guys here. I want to be as good. I want to wrestle like a guy. I want to, because I was the only girl. Mm. I became obsessed with it.
Yeah.
And there was, in my life, I wasn't sporty when I was growing up. I never had an interest in anything. Mm. In anything when I was a kid. My brother played guitar.
Nice.
He was an artist. Like, he just had all these talents. Mm-hmm. I never had a talent in my life.
Right.
I don't have any talents.
You have good work ethic.
But I never had anything that even pulled me to want to be better at. Mm. But when I walked into that wrestling school, and there wasn't even a ring there. We had 6 blue mats on the ground.
How'd you find it?
So I kind of went in reverse, where I was a little, I was drinking too much and smoking stuff that I shouldn't have been smoking when I was 13, 14, 15. Right. I had a kind of little hard time in life those years. And I was sitting there one day, 15 years old, wanting a beer on a Monday. I had failed PE and I was like, I need to get my life together, you know?
At the tender age of 15, I've had enough.
I was like, I need to get my life together. You need to get your stuff together, Rebecca. Come on, you're going down a bad path.
Mm.
And I was an alternative kid as well.
Mm.
And it's so crazy, the parallels. We were in two different places in the world, but at the exact same age.
Yes.
I was like, I need to do something.
Mm-hmm.
But going to a gym was too conventional. It was too mainstream. Everybody was doing it.
Mm.
So I was like, oh, I'm a little scrappy. I was a little tough kid.
Sure, yeah.
Even though I wasn't in shape or whatever or athletic, I was like scrappy.
Yeah.
So I decided that I was going to do a kickboxing class, but I'd watch wrestling. I was a big wrestling fan.
Mm.
But that wasn't even in my field of visions or dreams. That was in America.
Right.
That was like... People from Ireland weren't wrestlers. What are you talking about? I could never do that.
Right.
But my brother found out that there was a wrestling school in England and he was going to go across, but he was 19.
Mm.
So he'd be allowed to do that. I was 15. There's no way I was going to be able to. He found out that Fergal, Finn Balor, was going to be opening a wrestling school. And of course he was...
Was it in Dublin?
Yeah. Okay. Well, it was in Bray, which is like an hour and a half away.
Okay.
And Finn Balor wasn't Finn Balor at the time, obviously.
Sure.
But it was just anybody was opening a wrestling school in Ireland, and Tough Enough was huge. So I had these visions that I was going to go down. There's going to be this big giant warehouse.
Things.
Yeah. There's going to be a big giant warehouse. There was going to be a sign on the door. I was going to walk in. There'd be these giant muscle-bound men and women.
Yeah.
And I walk into this little school gym. There's 6 blue mats on the ground. And everybody's like a scrawny little teenager. With half
an Irish kid.
Yeah, half grown out long hair. Because they all wanted to be the Hardy Boys or Agent Christian or whatever. And so I walk in and it's nothing but that. And there's Fergal, and at the time he's a skinny lad and big smiley head on him. He's like, "Harry," and that was it. And I just, ever since the first time I walked into that place and I took my first bump and I was terrible and I was awful, but it was a community that I wanted to be involved in, and it was something that I wanted to get better at. And I'd never had that feeling before.
Mm.
And then, I remember the first time stepping into a ring. Like, we got a ring 3 months later. And, like, being
in that ring. I have
chills
even hearing you say that.
I was like, what is this? This is a real wrestling ring. This is a real wrestling. I couldn't get over the fact that I was standing, that I had watched this thing on TV.
And you were doing it.
And I was standing in a wrestling ring.
Mm.
Holy moly. And even when I remember being in NXT, and I don't think the novelty ever wore off on me, just like looking around. And
probably not even now.
Nah.
It doesn't for me.
No.
I get as excited now to go on stage as I did my first show.
That's amazing.
You know, maybe not quite as excited, I should say. Like, I don't get that, like, oh my God, I have a show today. Like, so, so, so happy each day. You can't do that 7 days a week.
Yeah.
But I love it as much.
Do you still get nervous?
No.
Okay.
No. For a special event, for Mania.
Yeah. So, What does that look like in terms of?
So it's usually like 6 weeks on, 5 days off, 4 weeks on, 10 days off. So for you guys, it's midweek, right?
Yeah.
It's like, what's your schedule like?
Every week. So it's 52 weeks a year, but it's Saturday through Tuesday, get home Wednesday.
Mm-hmm.
And that's
so if you're home Thursday, Friday.
Yes.
Every week.
And Wednesday.
And Wednesday.
Yes.
Is a travel day a day off, do you think?
How do you mean?
Like, so for me, when I think of a day off, if I have a travel day that day, I'm like, that's not a day off because you're traveling all day.
Okay, so I feel like for me, a day off is any time I don't have to wrestle.
Okay, yeah, yeah.
Not, I say have to wrestle as if it's a chore.
Sure.
When I don't get to wrestle.
I love
it's
that.
It's a day off. So if I land on a Wednesday, plane sleep is my best friend.
Mm-hmm.
So I will sleep on the plane so that I don't have to come home and take a nap.
Yes.
Right? If I feel like, yeah. So then that Wednesday is...
Is your free day.
Is free.
You do the early flights?
I do the early flights.
I don't like the early flights.
I hate the early flights.
But you do them.
But I do them because I want to get home.
You get your day.
Exactly.
Yeah. I think if I had that, if I had this like 2 days a week home, I would take the early flight too. Because I do take the early flight to come home from tour when I can.
Okay.
Like anytime it's like, hey, if I'm flying home to LA, I'll take the 6 a.m. anytime because it gives me more time at home.
Exactly. And then because of the time change.
Yeah.
Usually, right? You're going the same way.
Yeah, usually.
Yeah.
It just depends. It depends where we're coming from. You know, sometimes you're like, hey, you know, we're coming from Austin. I'll be home in 3 hours. Other times you're like, oh my God, I'm coming from Tokyo. And I'm going to be home. But like, who cares what time you leave Tokyo? You're going to be tired when you get home. But it's just so crazy, you know, like this idea of being home, being the break.
Yeah.
You know?
I always say it because I love living in LA. I just love it. But every time I'm here, I go, God, I can't wait to live here. Because I feel like I'm never in one place. I'm always, and I don't know if you're the same, always waiting to go, or not waiting to go, but everything that I'm doing when I'm at home is preparing me to leave.
Exactly.
You know what I mean?
I haven't put my suitcase away. You know, I've lived with Josh in our house for almost 4 years, and I've never put my suitcase away. Like, it's never been unpacked and in the closet in 4 years because I'm always going somewhere. It doesn't make sense to take my essentials out of the suitcase.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? And I'm sure it's exactly, like, why would you unpack your suitcase? You need your toiletries. You need your vitamins. You need your extra pair of, you know, plain slippers or whatever your essentials are. Why would you take it out? Yeah. I don't actually have that, but whatever it is. Whatever it is that, you know, like, I have my bus slippers.
Okay.
You know, like, I have my comfortable, like, my slippies that I put on in the bus because you don't want to use a bathroom bare feet on a moving tour bus, which is shared by mostly guys. Let's just say that.
Yeah, okay, that makes sense.
You can't go in there barefoot at night. So slip on the bus slippies and go to use the restroom.
Yeah.
And those are the little things, you know, why take them out of the suitcase? They're going back in 2 days or 5 days or whatever it is.
Yeah.
The bus will drive overnight. We'll play the show. Alice will do his meet and greet. We'll usually meet fans outside the bus or whatever. And then we will sleep on the bus and arrive in the next city. And either the hotel will have a gym or usually there's a YMCA or, you know, if you have like a 24-hour fitness or something with a chain, then you can find one nearby. But yeah, it's walk or Uber. Huh? And you don't think about it. You know, people think, oh, you're traveling, you get to see all these different places. And they don't think about really what you see is the airport and the hotel and the inside of the venue and maybe like a Whole Foods or something.
Yeah, Whole Foods becomes your best friend as well.
Yes. Can you imagine, like, you will understand the excitement of a touring musician when you see that there's a Whole Foods near the hotel.
So you guys get a hotel even though you have a bus?
We do get a hotel, okay. Yes.
How is bus sleep?
It's so comforting now. It's, you know, you get rocked to sleep by the gentle rhythm of the road. I find it really relaxing.
What about when somebody gets up? Does that not wake you up?
No, because you've got curtains on all the bunks.
Okay.
You know, we're in condo bunks, so we're one above the other. And so the only thing that really wakes us up is other people snoring.
Okay. Yep.
Which is, you know, that's just what you're going to get, I think. But besides all that, you know, everyone's really respectful. You know, if someone's watching, you know, Netflix in their bunk, everyone's using headphones. Or sometimes our drummer will listen to drum videos a little too loud. But
what about them getting up in the middle of the night?
No, because you don't really hear it.
You don't?
You know, it's just the curtain moving. And, yeah, I think it's just the little noises that you get used to.
I'm very heavy-footed. feel like I'm awake. Yeah, very heavy footed.
It's all carpeted.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, another little sleep hack that I found. I found a type of headphones called sleep phones. Have you heard of these?
No.
They're amazing for planes too. They're like a headphone that's in a headband. It's completely flat, lies flat on your ears, and you can lay your head and it doesn't poke into your ear at all. So I put a podcast or something on and I just sleep.
Oh.
Super convenient.
All right.
So I did not know.
Send me that link.
I will send you all the links.
We've talked about all the links that Needham needs to send me.
I'm vegetarian.
Vegetarian.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Is it harder to find food?
No, I don't think so. I really enjoy it. Mm-hmm. I think there's that, yes, something about me really loves that. I feel like, for lack of a bit, like, and especially seeing as I'm a vegetarian, this is very not the right appropriate term, but a hunter-gatherer.
Yes, no,
more of a
sense.
Gatherer than a hunter.
You're hunting the vegetables. It makes sense to me.
Exactly. So it's just that. And I like the, I like working within the, I like that boundary thing. You know, like I can't, there's not that freedom. Because it's not that choice anxiety. I can only get my vegetarian food from X, Y, and Z.
Certain
but
places.
What kind of local places can I find within those perimeters?
That's so smart.
So I love it. And I found that being vegetarian, I was being vegetarian for years and when I was a teenager and all that kind of stuff. And I was actually, when I started wrestling, I was 15. And I was a vegetarian at the time and I used to get slagged a lot for being a vegetarian.
Especially in Ireland.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. One, I was like a wrestler, so I was in all guys and they were all like big burly guys.
Eggs and stuff,
Yeah, and it was just like, and I thought that I needed the animal protein to gain muscle or whatever. So I went back to eating meat and then I stopped when I left wrestling. Then I went back to being a vegetarian and then I was, and then I thought, okay, I'm wrestling all the time. I'm going to need that energy. I'm going to need that protein.
Sure.
Need muscles, whatever. And then just over a year ago, whatever, I was doing a yoga class and I was like, you know what? I don't want to eat meat anymore. I don't think I would.
You had that cathartic experience in yoga. That's why we go to yoga.
Exactly. Like, to have those little
interventions. To have these moments of clarity, like, you know, as you're miserably sweating. Like, I do the hot yoga. We've talked about this. I do hot box rock and roll yoga in Hollywood, which you have to come with
which
me.
Which I still need to come. I've always had issues around food, right?
Mm-hmm.
Like, my entire life, always had. Well, like, I was an overweight kid. I failed PE. That's how I even got into wrestling. And, but then, and even then, like, my reason for leaving wrestling when I was younger, when I was a teenager, 19, I started getting into it because I thought I needed to look like a bodybuilder, a figure competitor, if they were going to sign me, right? Because I wasn't a model or nothing like that. So I got into bodybuilding and then it gave me really bad eating habits and I dealt with all sorts of eating disorders and bulimia and all that kind of stuff. But even when I'd overcome that to a certain extent, I was always thinking about food and there was always an issue around food. And ever since that day that I took that yoga class and I said, you know what, I'm not eating meat anymore. I don't know what it was, but for some reason, everything just kind of dissolved.
Sure.
And I don't know if it's just a timing thing in my life or whatever. And now I enjoy food. I eat whatever I want to eat, which is generally just good food.
Right.
I'm not as, I need so many proteins and carbs and whatever. It's just, I just eat what I feel like my body needs. And it's like become this more intuitive thing.
Intuitive eating, I think it's actually called that, right?
Right.
Yeah. I love that.
Which is something that you can't tell. Like, I've read so many books about whatever, like, eat this way, eat that way, listen to your body, be intuitive.
Right.
But when you've got an issue around food, you can't.
You can't be told to.
Yes.
It has to just happen or not happen. Because, so what you're saying is, I need to go vegetarian.
Well, no, I'm not. You look perfect and you're amazing. And it's whatever works
but it's
for
that struggle
whatever.
With food, you know?
Yeah.
Because I was that kid too. I was an athlete growing up. I did ballet from the time I could walk and gymnastics. And then when I started playing guitar, I stopped being athletic and I gained a lot of weight. I was, you know, I was always struggling with my weight in school. I know you started your wrestling journey at 15. I started touring at 15 too. Mm-hmm. And you start on this career path and, you know, you're in a very looks dominated industry. Like I was just saying to my mom yesterday, I'm not a vain person. You know, I'm not the person that obsesses over my looks, but I'm in an industry where people obsess over your looks.
Yeah.
personally, like, everybody's always going to have an opinion.
Of course.
No matter what, like, if you're in the best shape of your life, then
you're too muscular.
You're too whatever. Mm-hmm. And if you gain 5 pounds, 10, but sometimes I think we put almost too much pressure on ourselves as well. Because at the end of the day, our bodies are there to function, right? Mm-hmm. And it's how they function. Like for you, it's playing the guitar and it's having that energy to run around stage and be a rock star.
Mm-hmm.
And for me, it's going out there and wrestling. And I think as well, when I took the pressure off just trying to force my body to look a certain way and said, no, you're just going to function a certain way, that it started to maybe transform. And maybe I just stopped caring about it. I don't know.
I think when you stop caring is when it all starts happening.
Yeah. Yeah, absolutely.
That's the trick.
And how do you find? How do you deal with that and finding food places and things like that? And
it's hard.
Yeah.
You know, I eat the trifecta meals, the trifecta nutrition meals I have sent out every week. So they'll send them to the hotel wherever I'm at or the venue every Friday. And that has been a huge lifesaver because, you know, we're talking about Whole Foods. You're always trying to, you know, find, okay, I'm going to go to Whole Foods. I'm going to get some turkey slices and I'm going to get some cottage cheese and I'm going to get some apples and, like, just hope that it stays fresh long enough to eat it. And it's hard, you know, especially being on the tour bus after the show. There's pizza, there's, you know, there's snacks, there's salt and vinegar chips, there's, you know, all kinds of things to eat. So the first thing I did when I decided to get healthy on tour was I took all the snacks out of my dressing room because I had, you know, beers and chips and sodas and whatever. So I said, get rid of it. I want 6 waters, 2 sugar-free Monsters, and a fruit plate. And that's all I have now. So if I want a snack, I have to seek out a snack. I have to go, like, physically leave my room and go find an unhealthy snack. I didn't realize this until a few years ago that you guys actually rent your own cars and drive yourselves.
Yep.
So tell me how that works, like, if you're doing 4 days in a row, let's say.
So,
like, tell me about your week, like, in a nutshell, your travel week.
So, starts off on a Saturday, maybe a Friday night, because living on the West Coast, you gotta get a lot of red eyes, unfortunately. Mm-hmm. So, I will fly out early Saturday morning. Mm-hmm. I will land in whatever city it is. I'll get my rental car, then First protocol is coffee, obviously.
Yes.
Right, got to get my coffee because that's how I function. Go get my coffee. Usually work out. My trainer, Josh, he'll often hit up different CrossFit gyms.
Oh, cool.
Or else Cesaro, who's my workout buddy, I suppose, on the road, even though we don't work out together, but he's the only...
You work out in the same places.
Yes, he's the only one on SmackDown that does CrossFit as well. And he does a lot more lifting and kind of just does high-intensity workouts as opposed to CrossFit, really. Mm-hmm. But so we'll always go to CrossFit gym, so he'll either have a place or Josh will have arranged a place, and
That's cool.
I'll just land, I'll go there, get my workout in, and then go food hunting, which is my favorite thing in the world to do.
Yes.
And this is why having a car is so much easier than what I could imagine being on a bus would be, because I just love Yelp. So I always like...
I do everything on Yelp. Everything. That's how I found my organizer.
Oh,
do you have a laundry bag you take with you?
No, I just get one from
the hotel.
Oh,
one.
That's smart.
See, I have a laundry bag. I have a canvas laundry bag that goes with me. When I get home from tour, the entire bag goes in the wash along with the bag. I'll empty the bag into the wash. Throw the bag in the wash. Take it out, fold it, stick it back in the suitcase, and there's, you know, I have a closet full of clothes, but it's the same 10 t-shirts and 5 pairs of pants and 15 pairs of undies or whatever that just stay in the suitcase and get recycled.
How do you guys do laundry on tour when you're gone for 6 weeks?
So there will be laundry at the venues usually, you know, especially if it's a bigger place, they'll have washer dryers there. We carry, in the production cases, they'll carry laundry detergent and fabric softener and sheets and stuff. So it's really, like, you know, we do have production assistants that will do it if we say, like, hey, can you please do our laundry? But it makes me feel like a productive member of society to still, like, I'm going to put my clothes in. I'm not going to have someone else handling my delicates, you know. And but there's usually places there. In worst case scenario, we'll send it out.
Okay.
You know, you can say, like, hey, I need to send clothes out. And it's expensive. You ever try to do laundry at a hotel? It's like $6 per sock.
Yeah,
like,
no,
I'm
it
not
is.
Paying
yeah.
that.
Yeah.
One other girl on our bus, it's our production assistant, Amber. So it's there's a few girls on our tour. We travel with Alice's wife, who they've been married 42 years. She's actually been the ballet dancer in the show since the 70s. What? And she's still the nurse and the ballerina in the show today, which is incredible. Amazing. Like, you know, she doesn't look old enough to be married 42 years, much less, you know, dance and do ballet. But she gets her leg straight up in full, you know, arabesque or whatever the proper term is, straight up above her head every single night on that stage and does it.
Jesus.
So it's her, we've got our production assistant, Amber, who's on our bus, and then we've got another production assistant, Buji, who's female, and I think, and our pyro girl's female.
Okay.
Which I love. That's, you know, another woman in a man's world, our pyro girl, Diane. You know, she just, her job is blowing stuff up, and she's a badass, and she's the only girl on our actual crew. Pretty cool.
That's awesome.
But you travel with a lot of girls.
So we have our own, like, rental cars and stuff. Right. So when we land in a place, we go and we get our own rental cars. I travel by myself now. So I used to travel with Charlotte, and I don't want to have nothing to do with her anymore. why wouldn't they? What's the difference of a gender? You know what I mean?
No.
It should be regarded just equally, you know what I mean? And it shouldn't be a big deal either way.
To be a female wrestler or to be a female musician or whatever it is. I remember seeing all the female musicians that were, you know, that were known, that were getting big. And I remember thinking, I have nothing in common with a lot of these musicians.
That isn't the way that things are anymore.
No.
And it can't be. And it should never be. It just, gender aside, the job is to wrestle. Mm-hmm. The job is to play the guitar.
Yes.
Be good at your job.
Be great at your job.
That's
and undeniable at your job.
Be undeniable at your job because you just got one job.
Mm-hmm.
You're very lucky to have that job.
Yes.
Go do your job.
There are,
you know,
so many people all over the world that would give anything to be in that position.
Yeah.
And I think that all the time, like, you know, on those early flights, on those days in the gym, or on those days where it's just like, you know, I was just saying before we got on this, you know, I just did the math. As of yesterday, I'm about to start, you know, as of yesterday, I started 40-something days straight without a day off, you know.
Oh, my goodness.
And I'm like, oh, my God, you know, like you said earlier, I have to wrestle this day. Wait, I get to wrestle. And you think about what you get to do versus what you have to do and reframing your mindset into, I get to travel, I get to see the world, I get to play guitar for a living. And when you put it like that, how could you complain?
Yeah. I get to organize my place with these things.
Yeah, exactly.
Oh, no, that won't work.
That's not going to work. No,
that's not going
to
work.
Get to have
me.
Someone else organize
my place. I'm going to get to have somebody else organize my place one of these days. But yeah, and that's the thing. It was just about going out there and making people care and having it be called the women's, you know, belt or whatever, and just changing
instead
that term,
the Divas
changing
belt.
Yeah, changing that perception.
Yeah. How was that when you heard, like, did you hear that for the first time at that announcement, or did you guys have a hint before that it was going to get changed?
No, I think we just heard it at that time. I think
it seemed like it from a fan perspective. It seemed like a real reaction when Stephanie gathered everyone together and said, "We're changing the name from the Divas division to the Women's division."
Yeah.
It seemed like a real emotional reaction from you guys.
Yeah, it was. And then it was also just like, oh, well, yeah. And it was like, oh, my God. And then after
and
that
like,
settles,
well,
you go, ah, of course.
Well, duh.
Of course. Yeah,
why not?
Of course. Yeah. And then I just remember before the match not being at all nervous. And I was like, oh, I'm not nervous. It's weird.
Yeah, bizarre.
But I was so nervous that my body wouldn't let me be that nervous,
because
otherwise I probably would have fainted. And I realized that when I walked out, I was like, oh my God, why are there so many people? And I couldn't even, and what made me realize was that I was that nervous was that I couldn't even think about the match.
Right.
Weeks after.
Really?
And now I almost can't remember the match because I just blocked it out, because just the magnitude of it and thinking of over 100,000 people, like watching us wrestle was just like, you know? But of course, like we've got millions of people watching us every week.
Every
but
single
just,
week.
But there they were with their faces
with
looking
their faces
at us.
And their phones.
Yeah, with their faces and their phones looking at
us.
But I still get nervous every time we go out there.
I think back now in 2018, it's such a different landscape than when I first started.
Yeah.
Because I remember being, you know, 15, 16, 17 years old and being asked to leave dressing rooms because dressing room is for band members, not girlfriends.
Oh.
And I remember one time at the Whiskey in Hollywood actually standing up, physically standing up and closing the door and showing the security guard the flyer with my band's picture on it and saying, "Can I stay? This is my band. Oh, I'm supposed goodness. To be here."
Wow.
And you know, you always have that chip on your shoulder. You know, you as the only girl in an all-male gym, I'm sure it was the same thing. You know, you always have that chip on your shoulder of, like, even if you're tired, even if you're hungry, even if, you know, whatever's going on in your life, you can never show that to the world. You can never show that to anybody. And I carry that with me. I try to be as real and honest as I can on social media.
Yeah.
But I also try not to show those parts too much because I still have that chip on my shoulder and I feel like people will perceive a sign of weakness if they can.
Okay.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So it's, you know, I try to keep that personal struggle, those personal things, keep it to the side and put a strong front out and show the world a strong person, because the more you can act like that, the more you can become that.
Yeah.
I think. How was it for you?
Kind of different.
Really?
I don't know. So I don't know if it was my brother being there.
Mm. Oh, or did he actually train with you?
He trained with me.
Oh, how cool.
And yeah, there was a few comments thrown at me. Millions of comments thrown at me all the time, but I never remember them ever affecting me. I never remember getting upset. I would get upset with myself because I wasn't good.
Mm-hmm.
And I didn't know if that was... No, I would get upset and I would cry.
Right. Yeah.
And I would cry a lot.
Right.
But it was because I cared.
Yeah.
I never remembered feeling outed or less than by any of the guys because of being a female. I never felt like they expected anything less of me. In fact, I always felt like they always brought me up and they always brought me to the level. And I think that was part of why I did well in wrestling or became better, was I work really well on spite, but I also work very well with positive reinforcement, and they all helped me and they were all patient with me and they were just caring and they all became like brothers to me.
Mm-hmm.
And I never really felt that gender bias. Mm-hmm. I got it a little bit at one stage and I won't say when, but I remember being told, "Hey, move more like a girl."
What does that even
is
mean?
That I am a girl, I'm moving. You know,
exactly.
I don't
you can't
know.
Possibly move more like a girl. I am a girl. I am moving.
But I also think the other thing, and so it might be different in mine, is the importance of vulnerability. And I think women have that in spades.
Yes.
And I think that when we can show that, and there's not that it's not a weakness, it's caring about something.
Yes.
And it's caring so much that maybe it brings you to tears, and women, we're going to cry a little
I
bit
cry
more.
All,
I
think, the time.
All the time. But it means that we care.
Yeah.
And once we cry, it's done. It's not
out.
A thing. It's not a thing. It's not
Sometimes
a bad
thing.
Sometimes
you just need to cry it out.
Sometimes you just need to cry it out.
Yep.
And then we get on with it and we kick ass and we take over the world.
Yep.
Do you know
yep.
what I mean?
Exactly.
So it's that balancing point, you know,
yeah.
and it's always been, and that's been the great thing in my career. It's like, I got to play a lot with the vulnerability at the
yeah.
start. Now I'm just an ass kicker.
Now
I'm done with the vulnerability. I'm kicking ass. I'm taking names. But I think that was what endeared people to me.
Is you showing
is
your personality.
Showing that vulnerability, that suffering, that whatever. And then it's the
and
overcoming
then it's time
it.
To go.
And then it's time to overcome it.
Mm-hmm.
And then we snap into high gear.
Yeah, I will say
run
that.
Run this place.
That,
run this place. Control Chaos coming out November 16th through Sumerian Records. I cannot wait to get my hands on it. You should too. Make sure you go out there. The champ says go out there and get your hands on Control Chaos November 16th.
Woo!
That's what the champ says. Go on. True Sumerian Records. Go on. November 16th. Control Chaos. What are you doing? What are you doing? Start pre-buying.
Can you start pre-buying it now?
What are you doing?
She's
go!
She's
Sumerian Records! Control Chaos! Go! Start pre-buying!
26.